Oh, no, 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 They definitely measure it on service, and there's no question about that. The question is like, how do the samples?
No, it's, so we can do it in Zillow, right? You get function. From the stack and that.
Yeah.
I guess I also know how to do flying service.
You can fly service.
Well, it's a do. I'm just, well, I'm assuming you have to make sure we're like, make sure we're service, right?
Well, I made it. We do, but we've been just. Right.
Well, I guess you have to get, you get your cash.
There we go. Hello. All right. It's about 5 past. It looks like most people have stopped trickling in. So we're going to go ahead and start. Why? It's going automatically. That's not what I wanted. All right. So you're in NetVC. This is our first meeting. So hooray. Some quick administrative stuff. The first thing is Notewell, and we're actually not going to have you read this, but if this is not something terribly familiar to you, we're going to, you know, this is the quick summary, and the longer summary comes down to this working group, more than others, actually has stuff in the charter pertaining to IPR. So we really do take Notewell seriously, and I want to emphasize for this working group that if you're getting up to talk about things, there are certain obligations that are incumbent on you, and I want to make sure that you're aware of them and that you comply with them if you're going to be participating in here. All right, and then the normal administrative tasks. Alyssa looks like she wants to say something. Was that...
I was under the impression you were going to spend one more minute on that for people who might not actually, might just want to talk about what you expect people to do.
Okay. So
just what the Notewell says, but just for everyone's refreshment.
Right. So in general, the policy is that if you get up to talk about something that you have personal knowledge of IPR associated with it, you basically have an obligation to disclose in a formal way to the IETF the existence of that IPR. There's a very specific process you're supposed to go through. There is an IPR declaration page you go to indicate your knowledge. And it's definitely incumbent on IPR that is like associated with you or your company. And it's also strongly encouraged if you're aware of any third party's IPR associated with what you're talking about.
And just to add a little more, so historically people have viewed the IPR declarations negatively on a lot of the drafts, and I think in this work group we have a slightly different take on it. I think we're actually going to try to encourage as many IPR declarations as possible with an explicit grant of royalty-free terms. So as you're looking at any of this work, even if you're not directly involved in any of the work, but you know your affiliate has some video IPR that may be related, we really would encourage everyone to go out and influence their employers to submit RF IPR declarations against any of the drafts in this working group that your company may have some IP related to. So we really want to use the IPR declarations as a positive tool in this work group.
And I would just add, even with that in mind, if people have declarations that they're going to make that have different terms, it's important to know that as soon as possible, right? Because the whole point of the group is to design a royalty-free codex. So we don't want those coming in late and people not having the information at the early stages when the codex is being developed. Thanks.
So that was completely inaudible from the back.
Is the mic not on?
I think I just need to eat the microphone. Is that better? Can you hear me, Ted?
Yes.
Yeah? So I'm like standing so close to the microphone. Would you like me to repeat it?
Did I need to hear it? Because it was completely inaudible.
Fine. So, thank you for going back to Crazy Eyes Matt as well. So what I said was that in addition to encouraging declarations under royalty-free terms, if people are going to make declarations under other terms, it would be as more important than usual to make those declarations as soon as possible, because the whole point of the group is to develop a royalty-free codec. And so what we really don't want is for people to put a lot of energy into developing what they think is a royalty-free codec, and then at the end finding out because of late disclosures that there's a bunch of IPR that is not going to be licensed in a royalty-free way. So everyone, please focus on getting your declarations in early if you can. Thanks.
Okay, and now for the boring stuff. We got the blue sheets. You know what to do. They're right there. And we also need a note taker, ideally two, just to make sure that if someone has to stand up, there's someone else still scribing. And I'm going to use my normal technique of staring at the crowd until someone volunteers. Hey, Colin. All right. Martin? All right, thanks. So Martin Thompson will be scribing for us, doing note-taking. That was sparser than normal, so I'm not sure we can get an emergency backup note-taker. Is there someone who wants to fill in if Martin gets up to talk? I'm just saying. And finally, I don't know if we have anyone participating remotely this time, but just for the benefit, if there is someone in the Jabber room who wants to have something taken to the microphone, who is willing to sit in the Jabber room and do that for them? All right. Thanks. I have both Matt and Jonathan. Okay. And that's it for that. So, quick agenda bash. We're meeting two times this week. Today we're planning on talking about, I don't know exactly what, requirements, the test and evaluation criteria, and the tools and techniques that are currently applied in DALA. On Wednesday, we'll be talking about Thor, LAP transforms, and considerations involving screen sharing. If anyone has any comments on this, now would be the time to speak up. And seeing no comments, I'm going to ask Alexi to come up. Do we have the...
That's just definitely.
The
so I think you might have
to
use the microphone, and they probably want
yeah,
to stay in the
box. Yeah, speaker box. Yeah.
I think
inside
they
box.
Have a mic. They have a
stay inside the pink box. Inside of it. Yeah. Camera focus.
Well, hello everyone. My name is Alexia Filipov, and
today
And today I'll tell you about video codec requirements.
You can go ahead and pull it out and hold it. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, well, and today I'll tell you about video codec requirements. Please, the next slide. Well, my presentation will include an overview of applications, a list of requirements, and a high-level description of evaluation methodology. And finally, I'll conclude my presentation. The next one, please. Well, before proceeding to these six applications, I would like to say that, of course, the most important and the most basic requirement for video codec is compression performance, also known as coding efficiency. Well, and of course, I won't mention it any time, and I'll focus your attention on specific requirements for each application. Please, the next one. Well, the first application is in my list is IPTV. Well, in this case there are two use cases. Yeah, for IPTV there are two use cases: video on demand and broadcasting. Well, random access to pictures is an important requirement for both use cases. Well, other two requirements, such as temporal scalability, error robustness, are needed primarily for broadcasting. And an optional requirement is a resolution and quality scalability that is useful in many applications, not just in the case of IPTV. The next one. In this slide, you see typical resolutions and frame rates. This table, the information for this table was taken from different sources. And of course, potentially it can be extended by different informations, for example, with 8K, but I don't know, for example, about 8K resolution, or for example, with higher frame rates, but currently it's the information that I know. Well, the next one, please. Well, the next important application is video conferencing. Well, the most important requirement in this case is delay that should be kept as low as possible. Well, and it should be up to 350 milliseconds, but its preferable value should be less than 100 milliseconds. Yeah, it's more convenient. Yeah, for discussing when delay is less than 100 milliseconds. I mean, just for the codec. Well, and another important features are temporal scalability and error robustness. It's evident, I think, in this case. And of course, very useful features if we use different devices, handheld devices, and for example, PC. Yeah, of course, it's important to support resolution and quality scalability. Well, the next one, please. Yeah, here you see video typical resolutions and frame rates for video conferencing applications is taken from different sources and from different products, from hardware implemented products and software implemented products, like for example Skype. But it's typical resolutions and potentially this table can be extended.
Right. Echoing Jessup. 350 milliseconds is way too high for interactive. Even 100 milliseconds is really too high in regards to your previous slide.
Yeah, okay. But, well, of course, it's possible to calculate, and these values are taken from experience of different people, but okay, I'll take into account this information. Well, please, the next slide. Well, and the next slide is about video sharing, also known as video hosting. In this case, the most basic requirements are random access to pictures for downloaded video data, temporal scalability, of course, resolution and quality scalability would be very important as well, and of course, error robustness. And typical scenarios, yeah, typically the content for this application is captured by either smartphone cameras or cameras like GoPro. Yeah, please, the next one, the next slide. Well, in this slide, the information was taken from YouTube. Yeah, I mean, this resolution and frame rates are recommended by YouTube for uploaded data, to upload as recommended, upload encoding settings. Well, so of course it can be extended by other data that are used by other services, video sharing services. Yeah, please the next one. Well, and screencasting probably it's a bit another thing. Yeah, it differs from the previous applications that deal with primarily natural video. This application works primarily with content like graphic user interface windows, 3D graphics, and so on. And of course, in this case, the most basic requirements are support of different input video formats, well, and high visual quality, up to visually and mathematically lossless.
Hi, Eric Piscorla. Can you elaborate on error robustness in this case? Do you mean primarily packet loss or do you mean bit errors?
Both.
Because, I mean, almost all these things are going to be transported over encrypted transports, which do not permit bit errors.
Yeah, but Well, of course, I don't want to specify this because, of course, there are many space for discussion in this field about error robustness, and I think it can take too much time. Yeah, because it's not always it's evident, and I read comments on my document, for example, where there was a statement that, for example, error robustness is not needed, for example, for IPTV. Yeah, and of course it's. In my opinion, a difficult subject, and of course we can separately discuss this.
Sure, I guess, but we can discuss it, but I'm just saying the IETF is moving to all encrypted transports, and those inherently have integrity protection, which means they don't have bit errors. I mean, they may have bit errors, but they get rejected by the integrity check. So, like, there may be some need in, like, non-IETF for bit errors, but not here, largely.
As a chair comment, we originally had two drafts on requirements. And unfortunately, it came such a close time to the meeting that we didn't have adequate time to merge them well enough. So in the other draft, Jack Moffitt's draft, it did talk about bit error robustness as being an explicit non-requirement. And so I think we need to have probably Jack and Alexei to sit down and see whether or not they want to merge those two documents more thoroughly and have discussions about those points where they differ, and then bring that merged document back to the work group.
Okay, well, and the next one, thanks. Well, and in this slide, typical resolution and frame rates are presented for two formats, RGB and YV444. Well, the next slide, please. Well, and another interesting application that some experts think that it relates to screencasting, but there are some differences between game streaming and screencasting. There are some specific features, for example, like large and fast motion, yeah, in the case of games. So I think that it's reasonable to consider this as a separate application. Well, the most basic features are random access, temporal scalability, and probably error robustness, but of course it's a separate thing. Well, and optional requirements are resolution and quality scalability. Please, the next one. Yeah, resolutions and frame rates are the same, like in the case of screencasting. Well, the last but not least application in this list, in this presentation, is video monitoring and video surveillance. In this case, the most important requirements are random access to pictures, because it can be transmission can be started from an arbitrary moment, so it's an important requirement. And of course, another important requirement is low complexity encoder, because usually IP cameras, it's important to keep the design cheap and simple for IP cameras. So it's one of the important requirements, optional requirements. But very widely adopted by industry is high dynamic range, and optional requirements, very useful in the case of video surveillance and monitoring, are temporal resolution and quality scalability.
Speakers, can you just please stay inside the box?
Okay, yeah. Okay, sorry.
Yeah. For remote.
Well, it's typical resolutions and frame rates from real products. Of course, this table can be extended, but according to my experience with surveillance, shows that the listed resolutions and frame rates are enough for many applications. Well, the next one. Well, and now I have taken into account the listed applications. I'd like to formulate requirements that are divided into two groups according to their importance. First group is basic requirements. Yeah, please, the next one. Well, and as already mentioned, compression performance is the most important, and of course, if we want that this internet video codec would be widely adopted by industry, it should provide compression performance better than state-of-the-art codecs such as HEVC and VP9. Well, and a couple of words about input formats. Of course, the codec should support 8 and 10 bits depth. Well, and at least two color formats, YUV 420 and YUV 422. Well, and of course, for video conferencing, low delay configuration is needed, is obligatory. Well, and about delay, I got your point of view. Well, and the next slide, please. The next one.
All right, you're getting a comment on this one.
Mozenetti, just one quick point on the same thing that Randall mentioned in the Jabber room. Most of these codecs have an explicit zero delay form, and I think that in our evaluation criteria, we should probably try to explicitly have one of those as one of the test cases, that we always operate one of the codecs in zero delay form so that we can have results that are usable for video conferencing.
So I want to make sure that's in the notes, yes. Thanks.
Yeah. Just to clarify a question I heard in the room, Tim Terryberry from Mozilla. Zero delay means one frame in, one frame out. So presumably you see an entire frame in the encoder at once to process it. So it is not doing like subframe delays. But I think that's what Mo meant, right? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, well, and the next requirement is about complexity. Of course, real-time implementation of both encoder and decoder should be feasible for a wide range of different platforms. Well, the next one, temporal scalability is, of course, needed for wide range of application. And error resilience, well, of course, I'd like to say that these mechanisms should be complementary to that are implemented on transport level. So there are different mechanisms how they can be implemented in codec. Well, for example, using entropy coding. Well, the next one, and probably a short overview of optional requirements. Codec, of course, it would be highly desirable if codec would support extended bit depths up to 16 bits per call component. For example, primarily for screencasting, it would be useful to support color formats like YUV 444 and RGB. Of course, support of auxiliary channels such as alpha channel. Well, support of high dynamic ranges would be very useful. And scalability, resolution and quality scalability, and computational complexity scalability that in many cases we have in the codecs. Well, the next one, yeah. And about complexity. Well, of course, it would be great if codec would support, will support high-level tools such as slices, tiles, wavefront propagation, it's so-called high-level multi-core parallelism. And, of course, for tools, it would be important to support low-level instruction parallelism for separate tools. Well, the next one. And probably a couple words about compression performance evaluation. Well, about methodology and quality assessment. Well, the next one. Well, in my opinion, requirements do not make sense if a way how to check them is not defined. Well, so because it's in many cases it's a detailed description what should we get. Well, in this draft we describe just a high level evaluation framework.
Excuse me.
Yeah,
Patrick Linsky from Cisco. Before we move on from the requirements, one thing that's would be good to include in here moving forward is numbers for mobile devices. A lot of the numbers for frame rate and especially for resolution and especially for frame rate tend to be lower on mobile devices in adverse network conditions.
Yes, of course it can be lower. So in this case, I agree. Well, and for this we need temporal scalability. Well,
yeah, for sure. I just want to make sure that like the lower bounds in the current like requirement section don't go as low as what we see in the field for what we need. So I think it'd be good to reflect the requirements.
Okay. Well, and so, well, in this document, we describe just high-level evaluation framework, and we don't describe some details like a list of video sequences or concrete bit rates. Well, we describe just evaluation mechanism. Well, and in future, of course, in my opinion, of course, it would be great to get a document that would provide evaluation procedure for each requirement. But now in this document, we present an evaluation framework just for compression performance. The next one. Thanks. Well, in this document, we proposed actually, in order to compare codecs, it's necessary to keep close either bit rates or quality. Yeah, because for the quality, we don't have just one prominent metric that is close enough to human perception. So, in my opinion, it's easier to evaluate bit rates. Yeah, to fix bit rates, to keep bit rates close to each other if we compare two codecs. So, in this case, in this document we propose to have three ranges, namely low bitrate range, medium and high bitrate ranges. Well, in order to avoid any specific rate control mechanisms, we propose to have some deviation between bitrates of reference and tested codecs. It should be less than a threshold value that should be defined in a separate document. For obtaining an integral results for each range, beyond the guard delta rate should be computed. Yeah, finally. Well, the next one, please. Probably the next slide, please. And a couple of words about quality assessment, about objective assessment. We propose two the most prominent and well-tested metrics, PSNR and multiscale SM, because for them there are many different information about test results and so on. Well, PSNR provides good results for signal fidelity, and multiscale SM is close enough to human perception. And the next one. And of course, for the most important thing in evaluation is subjective evaluation. Well, we fully agree with this, but probably it's not enough to take a look at the picture, yeah? And, of course, we need a methodology. And for this, we propose mean opinion score that provides a numerical indication of perceived quality. Well, there are different variants of this methodology, yeah? At least two different variants for discrete scale and for continuous scale, yeah? And it's described in different standards, yeah, and this information taken from ISO-IEC, ISO-IEC standard. Well, and important advantages of this methodology is that confidence intervals can be calculated and some outliers can be rejected. Well, and probably the last slide. Okay. Well, in this draft, we presented an overview of Internet video codec applications and typical use cases. Well, and a prioritized list of requirements for an Internet video codec. Yeah, and because there are different opinions, there were different. In any case, we strongly recommend to the work group to include an evaluation framework into requirements output document, at least for compression performance. Well, because it's the most important feature. Well, and there were some questions from different sides about the necessity to compare a new codec with others, but if the work group states formulated them one of the main goals as to be better than state-of-the-art compression, of course we suggest performing comparison with the reference model of HVC. So thank you for your attention. Yeah, probably have a question.
Thanks. So it's Adam Roach from the floor, and I just have a couple of comments. The first is on the structure you're talking about here, having this type of stuff. I think this is good material to have. I do think it probably belongs more in the testing document than the requirements document, but that's structural.
Yeah.
The other comment that I had was you'd mentioned doing MOS testing, and my understanding is that that's a relatively rigorous and expensive process to go through. Have you thought about how that would be, you know, funded? Who would perform those operations? Or are we just going to go looking for someone to do that? Or are you thinking of something slightly less formal than that?
Well, okay, well, and it looks like a recommendation, yeah, probably. Oh,
I'm sorry.
Well, the last question. What?
The MOS scoring. I'm wondering if you're actually proposing we literally go through the MOS testing process.
Yeah.
Or if we're going to do some proxy, because I know there are like electronic proxies for that. Or if we're going to have something slightly less formal. Or I'm trying to get you to clarify what your proposal is in that area.
In the field of testing, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, well, of course, it should be, in my opinion, it should be formal. Yeah, more formal.
Okay.
Yeah, this testing, yeah. And, of course, if you want to get really good results, of course, we should demonstrate it. Yeah, this possibility of Kotick. For this, we need the formal results, formal procedure.
Okay. I want clarity around that. So, yeah, great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thomas Davis, Cisco. Just on this question of supporting lots of different bit depths and color formats, I think those are all kind of desirable to have maybe later on, but I think in the first instance we should focus on 420 8-bit video, at least internally. If what you're proposing is a requirement that we have some kind of interface for different color formats and bit depths and so on, then I guess that's fine, but that's more a requirement on the software than on the codec engine itself. Also from an IP point of view, 422 may be kind of tricky. There's probably IP around how to do that because you have to scale your blocks and things. So the easiest thing to do is maybe support 420 and maybe 444 from there. But I think we should focus on 4208-bit in the near term.
Well, in general, I agree with you. However, probably if you're reading, for example, future video in PEC, yeah, well, currently there is a really large discussion about color formats, yeah, and some experts proposes to focus. In contrast to your opinion, they propose to focus attention on 422 formats and 444 formats.
I think 422 is kind of nuts, but but certainly I understand that there's a whole range of things you can do around different color gamuts and wide color gamut and so on, and you code things differently maybe if you have those color gamuts and you have 444, but I think we need to walk before we can run in that case. Those are desirable things, and making them essential requirements, I think, would be kind of risky.
Well, but I agree that from practical point of view, of course, 420, of course, is more important, yeah? Of course, agree, yeah? But, for example, for applications like screencasting, and for this application, I think it's really important for an internet video codec. Well, of course, I think it's necessary at least to support it, RGB and YV444. Well, but if there are other opinions, but I don't know how are you going to support this mode without 420, just using 420. Well, I think it's almost impossible if you want to support screencasting mechanisms. If you want to have these mechanisms for video codec, if you want to use your video codec for screencasting, of course you should support these mechanisms, these color formats. RGB and YV444?
Mohsen Hadi, as individual, I think that I broadly took the requirements, especially the ones related to input source formats,
of course.
You know, resolutions and frame rates, and you didn't mention bit rates, but I assume you also meant bit rates, bit depths, you know, chroma sampling, all of those aspects of the dimensions of the input.
Yes.
I took that as you're just trying to survey everything that's there, and I think maybe it's useful to understand that they might not be requirements for every solution candidate to address in the first iteration, but we should avoid any tool which precludes expansion in any of those dimensions. If some kind of tool, you know, just, you know, prohibits operating beyond 420 or prohibits operating beyond 8-bit, we should avoid tools that can't extend the codec into that dimension. But we probably don't want to require as a mandatory requirement for the first version of a solution candidate to have, you know, to meet all the requirements of all of the
of course,
dimensions
of
the input.
It's not a mandatory requirement. It's an optional requirement, yeah? Probably you remember, yeah? Well, of course, it's an optional requirement. Of course, it's not mandatory. And I would like to, yeah, as far as I remember, there was one comment. Yeah, of course, it's considered, yeah, it's just input formats. Yeah,
not and the way most other codecs handle it is, you know, with profiles. You know, people don't usually like the having to go to the profiling route, but I think it's inevitable. Even VP9 has faced it and now has profiles for the different bit depths and chroma formats. So I think, you know, we probably need to, Thomas's point is we just need to focus on the simplest profile, the most basic profile for the first solution candidate, and then see how we can add on more advanced profiles.
Yeah, it's a basic requirements. Yeah, of course. The basic requirements is to support YUV 420. Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's basic requirement. Yeah. Another requirements are related to other color formats, optional. Yeah. And of course, to establish different profiles, separate profiles. Of course, it's a good point. Yeah. I agree.
Steve Botsko, were you proposing that interlaced video is a requirement? I wasn't sure, but it was listed on your input formats, but I didn't know if you were assuming that was a requirement or not. I think when on the IPTV slide, you listed interlaced formats. I was just asking if you were thinking those are required for this.
You want which slide?
Fourth slide, the IPTV slide. IPTV slides. With the requirements, yeah, or with table.
Next page.
The question is just interlaced. Do you have
interlaced formats here? And I didn't. You know, my opinion is they probably should not be required.
What?
1080i.
Interlaced.
576i. Interlaced. Yeah. Well, but well, okay. Well, and what in this case? I'd like to ask you, what do you mean? Yeah, for example, for tests or for what? Yeah, it's just examples of input formats. And for example,
yeah, that was my question. Whether these are examples or whether these are requirements.
Yeah, it's of course it's examples. It's examples.
Okay, I wasn't clear on that. Thank you.
That said, there's a conversation going on the mailing list as to whether interlaced is a requirement, and there have been some proposals on both sides.
Tim Terryberry from Mozilla. So I just wanted to echo, like Thomas, also think 422 is crazy and would be, you know, very pleased to see that not be a requirement. I do think 444 is important. And while I agree with Mo that, you know, clearly we have to walk before we can run and get 8-bit 420 working well, presumably this is a document for what we have at the end of the working group, right? So, you know, the presumption is that, yes, we're not going to meet everything at the beginning right away, and we might not even be testing everything at the beginning right away, but if the document lists it as a requirement, like the goal is to have it there by the end of the process, right? That said, this is, of course, the IETF, and, you know, we can publish a bunch of requirements and then publish a solution and say it doesn't actually meet all our requirements, and nothing stops us from doing that.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's stunningly like to the second on time. So now Thomas.
Real quick before Thomas. So Alexei, I think it'd be good if you and Jack could talk after this and work out how to do a merger of those requirements drafts so we can get something that you can propose for the work group next meeting.
Right.
Or in between.
And to the point around evaluation, you probably want to work with Thomas as well.
All right. I am Thomas Dady from Mozilla. I've written the testing draft for NetVC. So I'm going to be talking about three things. The first is basically the operating conditions. We're going to run our codec set to test them. The second is how we're going to measure the quality. And the third is what sequences we're going to be testing the quality on. Next. So everything I mentioned, almost everything I mentioned in this draft is actually already implemented on the Aure Compressed Jet software for objectively testing video codecs. So this automatically runs for DALL, and it also has Thor runs in it now. So I will mention when there's a couple things in here that are not yet implemented. But next. So the first thing I need to talk about is the operating parameter choices. So when we have these video codecs, we can configure them in many different ways. But it's important to configure them in fair ways so we get a fair comparison. And we can say, you know, when some tool or some codec is objectively better than another one using the metrics that we have. So these different parameters we can control include but are not limited to, like the rate control method, the maximum delay we allow, the frame type patterns we configure the codecs for, whether we allow any look ahead or two pass, it's also related to maximum delay. So we need to specify something that we can, you know, consistently apply to all the video codecs that we test. Next slide. So I'd also like to mention JCT L1100 is already a testing draft that was used for HEVC. So I reference this. There's a lot of stuff that differs from this testing draft for reasons that I'll explain later. But I did use it as a reference. So, yeah, basically. Next slide. So the two configurations I have specified in the testing draft are high latency and low latency. So high latency is the only one that is implemented in Aure Compressed Jet so far. It is testing 2 to 4 second video clips, which are typical for dash content. So this is essentially streaming media, high latency, for example, YouTube, Netflix, as well as high latency live streaming, like game streaming on Twitch, would fall under this category. So to try to get as fair as comparison here, this allows all coding tools, all rate control methods within these 2 second clips. So anything you can do to make the highest quality for a particular file size is allowed here. You can use look ahead, two pass. There are no latency restrictions within this. Next slide. The second configuration is low latency mode. Low latency mode is for basically real-time communication, in RTP for WebRTC, video conferencing, that sort of thing. So it uses much longer sequences. This is because the iframe interval for this content is typically very long. It could be arbitrarily long until a new iframe is requested. So we use 15-second video sequences here. There's no frame delay allowed. So the only delay that is allowed is actually just buffer size for the CBR mode. So the bit rate is also constrained. So you must stay within a certain bit rate in a certain buffer size. So you're allowed to vary, but you basically get this first in first out buffer that you're not allowed to go beyond. That is a constraint for CBR mode. This is currently not yet implemented in Aure Compressed Jet. I've not exactly specified what these exact buffer sizes are. They're likely to change. I've specified examples, but if you have input on this, I would be interested in it. And there's input. Okay.
Mazzanati from the floor again. So this is different than typical standardization efforts where rate control is explicitly removed from the comparisons. So I'm wondering,
I'm wondering how this is going to work out in practice because, you know, the codecs themselves, the design, algorithmic design of the codec itself may not have anything to do with the rate control. And so if you just implement different rate controls over these other codecs, you know, I have a hard time understanding how in a shootout you wouldn't bias the results by how good the rate control is versus how good the actual coding is.
Yep. So this is a big consideration. Basically, I have not found a good way to, you know, configure two different, totally different codecs with different coding tools such that they are both considered to have rate control off, because there are a lot of different mechanisms, for example, like, you know, adaptive quantization.
But do you think that's desirable? Do you think if you could turn them off, would that be desirable?
Yes. Yeah, so especially for comparing coding tools in one codec when doing when you're looking at a single tool on a single codec, it is desirable. It might be a good idea to actually add that mode to this testing draft. I don't think it is desirable for like finally evaluating the performance of the codec compared to other codecs. Or if we've achieved our goals, it is not as good.
So you don't think it's worth trying to push back on any implementations that don't support that to try to get a rate controlless mode to do our evaluations?
I think they need some sort of rate control mode in just to evaluate, because specific bitstream features are needed to do rate control. And so if you have no way to test it, if those features work or not or how good they are, that's not very good, because you need to implement that in the end to have a good video codec.
Okay.
And so if you have no way to test the features, then.
Okay. It just seems like we're adding another dimension of complexity to the analysis, but it may be a necessary evil to tackle.
Hi, Del Elvis, John. Just making a shameless plug for the implementation that does some of this, which is comparecodecs.appspot.com. Of course, I have the complete opposite reaction to Mo, which is that comparing codecs without rate control is useless because it doesn't resemble what we do in real life. But I think we can get rate control testing reasonable by saying, okay, proponents of a codec need to implement the best rate control they can. If they cannot manage to get rate control right, then they have a problem. They have a problem. We don't have a problem.
So I'm going to take the opposite view again and echo what Mo said. I think it's you're adding a whole level of obscurity as to whether a tool is giving you gain or not, when it may or may not interact well with your particular rate control implementation. So this came up a lot in the MTI discussion in WebRTC. And standing on the sidelines and trying to make comparisons was really difficult. And what came out was that neither rate control in X264 or the libvpx was actually suitable for our requirements of very low delay. So it wasn't actually real world in either case then doing rate control. So we had to spend some time analyzing what the bitstream was and what what frame patterns there were and so on, which is kind of hidden when you have rate control. You can't see how it's allocating bit rate around. So you can't see where the gains are coming from, whether they're coming from the tools or coming from your rate allocation, and whether they're coming from doing two pass and doing lots of clever stuff. And you have to apply your intelligence and judgment as to whether or not you can apply rate control. You really want to get behind that and understand whether the tool itself is giving you gains. And we're not comparing two different codecs in this project. We're building one codec, or we're hoping to build one codec, and trying to determine whether a tool gives a gain in that. Now, I do agree that it should be possible to do rate control, and that should be a feature of the model that we produce. And it should be possible to do good rate control, and we should test that. But in determining whether a tool goes in or not, I think it should be possible to be able to run it in a non-rate controlled mode. because, and I also think it should be possible for people to be able to contribute without putting a huge amount of effort into optimizing rate control rather than optimizing their tool. You know, there's a limited amount of brain power that you can apply, and we should try and focus it on the tools.
Just a brief interjection. I agree with you on when we are evaluating a minor tweak to a codec. In that case, rate control is completely useless. Actually, the comparison is pretty useless in many cases too. But when we are doing the comparisons mandated in the our requirements for comparing against H.264 and VP9, then rate control must be included, my opinion.
Steve Botsko again. So I'm wondering if really we have two separate scenarios here and we're trying to conflate them in when we talk about testing. One is the codec development process. And in many of those cases, I would agree that it's maybe better to have rate control off as we're trying to validate whether particular changes to the codec make sense or not, whether they're major or minor. I don't know if that matters or even what that means exactly. I think when you're done, you definitely need a good rate control. So at the end, if you haven't validated with rate control, you probably have made a mistake. But along the way, I think it would be better if people can contribute tools, you know, and show how they perform and not have so many variables in the test sequences. They can't really even tell how their tool, you know, worked for a given test sequence. Another comment I had, too, is on this particular slide. I'm not so sure that we want a constant bit rate mode in this codec necessarily. It would seem to me it might be perfectly fine to allow the codec bit rate to vary based on what's in the input test sequence. And going to a CBR mode with a buffer model, particularly for video conferencing, you know, there's a lot of ways people will do rate control there as well, but strict CBR is not necessarily a good thing for an internet codec.
Eric Piscorla. Well, first I wanted to echo what Thomas said. Hopefully we're not proceeding to a shootout in a year when we have like mechanical validation and we like determine that codec A is like 0.001% better than codec B, and so we have to pick A. That would be quite silly. Hopefully we're primarily trying to develop something collectively that's better. And when I look at the charter requirements for what we have to do, they're actually quite vague on what competitive means. Again, I don't think we need to have a, you know, mechanical validation of, oh, we didn't, you know, in this respect, we're 0.1% worse than 265, so we can't ship at all. That would be quite silly as well. The second thing I wanted to observe is that, that this is software up here, and it's just like money being spent on computers basically to like run the tests with like different things. So I don't think we should get too bent out of shape around exactly what tests, you know, we run in our continuous integration profile when we look at things. I know kind of what we're spending on that, and I'm sure we could spend more if we had to. So I think that this seems like a fine model to run. If someone wants to contribute another model that we also run when we look at things, that seems also quite valid. And people can largely decide for themselves which ones they want to look at to be most important and use their own judgment.
Matt Miller, reflecting for Jessup in the Java room. Can we find the bits of rate control that matter, like delay in response to a bit rate change or time to quality after a change, and test those? This may answer if changes affect the ability to do rate control. He also says, there was a statement by Thomas that codec details interact with the rate control, so this would focus on those bits.
So that sounds like, you know, response to different network conditions or something. That could also be that's a very rate control specific test condition. It would probably be also important to add. So, I'm not sure exactly where that belongs, but it is probably something we do want to test for eventually if we want to test a particular rate control implementation.
This is Adam Roach from the floor. I just wanted to point something out without necessarily advocating for CBR as much as pointing out that we might want to take this into consideration. In the video draft for WebRTC, one of the things that's mentioned is that with the increase of the use of like IP cameras for surveillance, you frequently will end up with situations you have things that are predominantly static and will come across as low bit rates on a VBR, and motion will be very obvious. And that can actually be sensitive information, that there is something moving in front of this camera versus not. So a CBR rate would mask that, and it might be something that serves value in that arena, you know, depending upon what the cost of implementing that is.
So Tim Terrybear from Mozilla again. Going back to the previous comment about reacting to changes, I think the place where that belongs is the RMCAT working group.
John, thanks. I think what this was saying is reacting to the input RMCAT gives you. Basically, when RMCAT tells you, hey, your bandwidth just dropped by half, how quickly does it take you to look good again?
Well, the problem is you need some way to evaluate that, right? And I think coming up with a way to evaluate that is RMCAT's job.
Okay. At least what I got from that was a pretty good consensus that we do want to have at least a rate control-less settings for being able to test individual tools, and that is something that we should probably look at adding to this draft. So that will be added in the future. Okay. So next is quality measurement. There are two forms of quality measurement. They are objective and subjective. Objective is what we use these like tools like PSNR for. Subjective was, this is already kind of, you know, in the last presentation where we do MOS scores. I'm going to talk mostly about objective testing. We will probably also want to add subjective testing. I do not exactly know. I don't have any particular opinions on the methods used yet. So I will not be presenting them today, but they're something to consider. Next slide. So we currently have four different objective metrics implemented in rCompressJet. The one that is most familiar is PSNR. It is just a mean squared error. It is very simple to understand. It works really well for some things. It's something that, you know, everyone can agree on, you know, correlates with quality. It tends to not do as well for perceptual effects in human visual models. So we want to, you know, you have to be very careful with it because you can often tune towards things that don't actually look good but give great PSNR numbers. So next slide. This is just an example. Probably will not be visible on the projector, but I have two pictures here. If you flip between them, that's not very easy to see. It's an example of generally, you know, one particular codec feature improving visual quality but decreasing PSNR. Maybe look at the slide on your own computer or something if you want to see that in more detail. Next slide. So we have three other objective metrics. I'm not going to go into detail of the math of them, but they are SM, PSNR, HVS, and a particular implementation of MSSSM, which was mentioned before. These different metrics have different, you know, strengths and weaknesses. So what we've generally been doing is running all four of them and using them all together to decide whether, you know, overall some feature is better or worse, or some particular tuning. One danger of having a lot of metrics is if they all show different things, you can just, you know, if you have one metric, you know if you're better or worse. If you have four metrics, then they all disagree, you have no idea. But in general, if they all go one direction or the other, you can generally, you know, get good information. You have to use some human reasoning if they go different directions. It often indicates you're into some perceptual thing that you will actually have to look at visually. Next slide. And one thing I wanted to mention is that we use a couple of these metrics, we actually have particular implementations that give logarithmic results. And there are a lot of different implementations of these, so it's important that we stick to a particular implementation of the metric. So we have Sieg's implementations of these in the dollar repository. So the draft references these C implementations as the actual implementation that we use for these codec comparisons. So we need to always use those same implementations. Next slide. The other thing to keep in mind about these is that they only taken about Luma right now. Some of them can take into account Chroma. A lot of the perceptual, like PSNR, is very easy to do on Chroma, but it's harder to interpret the results, especially with the more perceptual metrics. There's been some research, but there's not a clear way to exactly evaluate Luma, Chroma components. So these are all currently run on Luma only. That's something that we need to look at. It needs to be taken into account when comparing rate control and changing when you change anything that would change Chroma coding, for example. The other thing is that these are all still image metrics adapted to video. This means that motion effects and frame misalignments and things will negatively affect how these work. So it's incredibly important that you have a one-to-one correspondence. So you need to, if you have features like interlacing, you need to output, if you're like, our codec does not support interlacing, you have interlaced content, you need to deinterlace it first, and then your reference needs to be to the interlaced version. Again, if you have something like frame dropping on screen sharing or like, you need to frame drop before doing this at the very input, so that you're not comparing two different frames, basically.
I'm Mosinati from Formic again. So I think it'll be important for us to take both Chroma and temporal effects into account. I realize we might have to break new ground on the temporal side. I think for Chroma, don't a lot of people just do a linear model of, you know, Luma, you know, plus, yep, you know, one third Chroma or something like that, each Chroma component. Yeah. So we should be able to, you know, do the Chroma part without too much damage, but finding a decent metric to at least reject, maybe that is a metric of goodness, but a metric of badness, something that would obviously highlight a temporal, you know, temporal noise issue. Some kind of metric like that to penalize codecs which are obviously producing temporal noise. I think that may be an important thing to have as part of the evaluation.
Yep, and there's several other effects like keyframe pulsing and the like are very common that are temporal, and these will not capture.
And they're ripe for abuse because a lot of times you can get PSNR gains using some of them, even though you may get visual, you know, temporal noise out of it.
Yep, and. Currently, we don't have, none of these are even close to perfect, so that is something we need to watch. And if anyone has suggestions on better metrics that they know of that are tested that we can implement, that would be great.
Yeah, well, just really to echo that, and my favorite metric is whether I like it or not.
Yes.
So you can get weird pulsing effects, but it's also very content dependent. We really should be making sure we test on things with lots of graphics content, text, as well as video, video conferencing content, general broadcast, internet streaming content, and so on.
And a lot of this also requires, you know, you basically need to use subjective testing, even something very simple subjective testing, just to verify that your metrics are doing the right thing is important. And that is probably also something that probably should be specified in this draft in the future, so that we can actually, we will hit effects where these all disagree with visual performance at some point. All right, I was going to just go into presentation that we actually present the results of these objective metrics. They're traditionally graphed on this curve. It has rate on the bottom and quality on the left. So as bit rate goes up, quality goes up generally, and there's usually two ways of presenting this. The most common is with a linear scale. This is what you'll see in most papers. And there's also another type. There's also a logarithmic scale. This is presents the bit rate on the bottom logarithmically. Technically, for many like PSNR, there's already a decibel scale on the left. But this actually provides a more linear view. And this is important because this is actually the view that is done for BD rate, which was described in the last presentation. So next slide, we have BD rate. If you want to present a single number, like you want to say our codec is 50% better than this other reference codec, BD rate is what you want to use. So it basically calculates the area between the two curves. It has bounds, and those bounds are very important. Basically, they say, you know, what rates do you care about? Those were mentioned in the requirements draft. They are defined in my draft. We will probably want to look at exactly what those bounds are. I've specified some bounds, but We may want to actually look at the applications. The other thing is a bounds are currently by rate. We may want to actually do bounds by quality instead or metric score. But that needs to be looked at in the future. Next slide. That is just an example. You pick bounds and you calculate the area, and that is your BD rate score. So finally is test loops, or actually a question.
Moe Zanetti from the floor, Mike. Again, back on the BD rate, and in general, your metrics, your visualization of the metrics, like we were discussing before about having, you know, two different modes of operation, you know, tool development versus full-blown codec comparisons. Maybe it's useful to think about what metrics may be good for, you know, for consumption by the people doing, you know, small tweaks and tool development, and what metrics and visualizations may be good for people doing large scale, you know, comparisons to other codecs. I think a very important part of this work, the most visible part of this work to other working groups and to the industry as a whole, is going to be, you know, the large scale codec comparison. How do we visualize that? How do we show that NetVC produced a good codec, a better codec than the rest of the industry is using? And I'd like to make sure that we have a visualization that you know, doesn't require hours of discussion and explanation on these metrics to figure out how to convey to people.
Yep. And I think probably whatever that visualization would be, it would be derived from BD rate, because BD rate is the thing that gives you the nice number, like 25% better given a certain rate. So you could, in the requirements draft, there were basically three different rate ranges that were specified. So you'd say low rate, we're this much better, medium rate, and high rate. So maybe more explicit, we want to be more explicit about that in this draft. That information will be derived from the speedy rate.
So does RB Compressor already generate both the curves and the BD rate numbers?
It does.
Okay. So we may already have 90% of what we need.
Yep.
Great.
It's, of course, very important what the ranges are for BD rate. So we want to make sure we all agree on that. All right.
There's a little trick with BD rate. Hey, I'm Harald again. Little problem with BD rate is if one of the codecs doesn't produce the number you expect, you really have a problem computing it. Like if one of the codecs was actually better at the bottom of your range than the other one,
yep,
then numbers get strange.
Yes, like if they cross over at some point.
Yeah, crossovers are another problem. I was thinking of the problem where you want to measure the distance between this curve and this curve,
mm-hmm,
and this curve actually goes.
Yes. So it's important that the curves both cover the window that you're integrating through entirely.
Just a warning.
Yes, it's probably not specified and should be explicitly in the draft. Actually, it might be. But okay. Next slide. We also need these test clips, basically. Being the 2 to 4 second ones, actually, they're the same number of frames, just the frame rate controls, which if they're 2 or 4 seconds. So we have the Video HD 2 set, which is a brand new set that I just made, that includes a bunch of 1080p 8-bit 420 clips from the ZIF's test media collection. That's for the high latency testing. We have a copy of lossless 4K tiers of steel for 4K IPTV kind of testing. That's actually chopped into a bunch of small segments. We have a set of screenshots, a bunch of different things. That those are actually static right now. We also have this, not mentioned here, is a subset of static images for testing purely intra-performance. We need more video test sets, so if you have a big cache of lossless test files that you would like to donate to this effort, that would be great. Especially for, we also have a video conferencing set, but more of those is always good. The general requirement for these test clips is that we want our results, basically, when we later publish results of our codec, we want everyone to be able to go and run it for themselves and verify that those results are in fact reproducible, which means that we do want these test clips to be redistributable to anyone in ITF for or it just in the general public for the purpose of testing this codec. So I think that is basically it for this presentation. So you can see more. There's on the wiki, we have links to all this stuff. You don't have to write down these URLs and just search for Dollar Wiki and find it. But I have the sources for all these tools. Those are in a Dollar repository. And our compressed JET scripts that run all the different codecs are in two separate repositories. You can also just view our compressed JET and run the tools for yourself in a browser. So, questions? Or more questions than there were before?
People sense that this is something that is heading in the right direction for the work group to look at as our performance evaluation criteria? There's nods or?
I see some thumbs up to nods.
Everyone likes videos? Question.
Eric Scrolla, does it make sense to have metrics which are perhaps less appropriate for being run with every commit because they take longer? So I don't know, much longer videos or some shit like that. I mean, I guess I'm just wondering, like it's great to have continuous integration, and obviously you don't want to burn like ridiculous amounts of machine time every time someone changes a semicolon. But is it worth maybe, are the things you would do here if you had unlimited machine time that would be sensible?
Yeah, I think the main thing you would do is simply increase the number of videos that you test. So it would make sense for occasional runs to basically do much, much longer, bigger tests. Longer videos, maybe. A lot like the content delivery trends now are basically with Dash, these very short clips, so it would probably be more like lots of short clips rather than...
Well, what about for video conferencing, where they're...
Oh, for video conferencing, yeah. For low latency, yes, you would use either more clips or longer ones. It depends.
I don't know much about this, but I'm just thinking, like, especially, you know, having really long clips that would, like, yes. Or Cullen only moves a little bit with this stripy shirt.
Well, yeah. If more computation time, longer clips are better because they more accurately represent, basically, because very, very, very long iframe intervals are used in video conferencing. And so you'd want to represent it as accurately as possible in your testing.
Thank you.
Patrick Linsky from Cisco. Three comments. One follow-up to Ecker's comment. There are certainly numbers greater than, you know, 15 seconds and less than hours that are useful to be testing in a conferencing scenario. You know, like if you can make it, I mean, an hour is actually a really fantastic one, right? If you can make it through an hour, then most of your video conferencing needs are going to be met. And you know, implementations certainly do fall over in weird ways after 15 minutes or after 30 minutes or what have you. So I think there's value for that. You know, AWS instances are billed by the hour. So once you've started one, I mean, you might as well use it for the rest of the hour. And they're not expensive. And finally, have you looked at all at Mechanical Turk or equivalents for doing human level validation of acceptability criteria?
So the first thing, basically, I agree that yes, we should run longer videos. They are set as short as they are just to have much faster runs.
Yep.
But I think also the codecs, the codec implementations we have right now are very slow and unoptimized. As they get faster, we'll also be able to much more easily run very long sequences. So, if it's known that we actually have problems falling over after like 15 minutes. If that's actually pretty common, we should definitely include those as some sort of test set that we can run at least occasionally, or much more frequently as our codecs get faster.
One of the things we do is daily runs that are slower than the per check-in runs.
Okay.
So Tim Terrier from Mozilla, I would actually like to argue the opposite, that if you have more CPU time, you should be using more short videos instead of fewer longer videos. So there are a couple of reasons for that. So one is that your metrics are generally only valid over relatively short sequences. So if you want to evaluate what the correlation of PSNR is with human perception, you know, under arbitrary conditions, it's very low, right? But under very specific conditions, it is actually reasonably high, as in, you know, greater than 0.9, whatever. And one of those specific requirements is that you're operating on short sequences. The other one is, you know, a given sequence, like the content in a given sequence is very highly correlated with itself, right? And so your ability to get broad coverage is limited by your number of sequences and not the number of frames you have processed. So if you're going to process more frames from many different videos. And I think that will get you, that will find more problems than simply processing longer videos. There are certainly classes of problems which only show up after a certain number of frames. You know, things like error buildup and some that we have seen already in our development. And so you do want to make sure you have something long enough to capture as much of that as you can, but no longer.
So just as a point of process, we're getting very close to the end of this slot. I'd like to go ahead and cut the line where it is. No. Don't sit down. But just, I don't want anyone else to get up. Thanks.
Okay. Thomas Davis, Cisco again. Yes, I basically agree with that last point. I think having more variety is better than having more of the same thing. The other point I would make is if you're doing these runs, it's also worth capturing not just these average numbers, but looking at worst PSNR, worst of each of your metrics on each frame, because that will help a little bit in capturing some of these temporal effects if there's strong variation from a tool. But also if you are going to run rate controlled tests, that will tell you maybe that your rate control is a bit broken.
Still Patrick Linsky. Regarding the diverse input comment, I think also from a video conferencing standpoint, very important to test with diverse video cuts within a sequence. You know, imagine video on me versus video on Cullen or whatever, in different with different backgrounds and different cameras and, you know, totally different feeds. And on the decode side, to the extent that you're looking to test the decode side of things, those sorts of significant changes in environment obviously have important, you know, there's an iframe there, but there's a lot of propagation that happens there. So error propagation across that boundary is an important thing about it.
Okay, yep.
All right. Thank you very much, Thomas. And now we have Tim and or Jean-Marc. I don't remember who's going first. All right, thanks.
All right, so we have shown slides at the IETF before on DALA, but they've always been rather brief, and so I thought it would be worthwhile to have somewhat more in-depth presentation of the various techniques in DALA. So to start off with, we have basic block diagram here. It may be a little bit different than you're used to seeing in that the blocks are the pieces of data and the arrows are the operations that move between the data. But we tried doing it the other way, and it came out being harder to understand, so we went this way. So this looks fairly similar to your typical motion compensation plus transform codec. The major difference here is that when we have this input frame and we use reference frames to feed into OBMC to produce a prediction frame, and in a normal codec, you would then subtract those two things and code the residual, and that is not something that we do. So we actually send both the input coefficients and a transform version of the prediction frame to come up with prediction coefficients into PVQ, which is our quantizer, to produce quantized coefficients. And it does not do that subtraction and residual coding. It does something else that we will talk about in more detail. But then that gets fed into, you know, a dequantization and inverse transform gives you a decoded image and feeds back into reference frames. So that is the basic structure for interframes. So for intraframes, they're very similar, the next slide, except that we have different ways of coming up with these prediction coefficients since we cannot use reference frames from the past. So we have two different things that we use. In the Luma planes, we have horizontal and vertical interprediction, which is basically just done by copying coefficients, and we'll talk about that in some more detail later. And then for the chromoplanes, we predict our chromoplanes from the Luma plane coefficients. But the rest of the process winds up being the same. The only real difference is that for our quantization, we handle DC slightly differently. We have a tool called Hard DC, which basically does a transform over groups of DC coefficients, which is not used in interframes. But so that this is sort of the high level view, and now I'll start going in and talking about some of these things in more detail. So to start off with our transforms, the transforms we use are lap transforms, and these are basically implemented by having a pre-filter that sits in between the block boundaries on the encoder side. And that feeds into a regular block-based DCT.
Sorry, Tim, can you stand inside the box?
Oh, sorry. And so then on the decoder side, we do the IDCT in these blocks and then run a post-filter that runs in between each of these blocks. So the post-filter is basically our deblocking filter, but unlike the traditional deblocking filters that people use, it is not adaptive. So it always runs, and it always runs with the same strength, but it is also invertible, so it is the exact inverse of the pre-filter we run on the encoder side. All right, next slide. So a few more details about our particular implementation of these transforms. So there's a draft on them that goes into much more detail, and Nathan is going to be presenting that on Wednesday. But just to give you some rough idea of how this works, our sizes, we support anywhere from 4x4 up to 32x32. We have a 64x64 transform in progress. One very important property of these is that they are reversible. So the inverse transform of the forward transform of a given set of pixels will always give you exactly those pixels back. And that winds up being important because we don't have things like a loop filter to smooth out noise and those sorts of things. We want to make sure that we don't introduce any additional rounding errors when nothing changes. These transforms are also bi-orthogonal and not orthogonal. So not all of the basis functions have the same magnitude, so we'll have to do some corrections for that. There also means that there is a slight correlation between some of the coefficients, and we're currently just ignoring that. So it may be possible to get some more additional gains by trying to consider that, but we haven't tried to do it. So next slide. So as I said, our motion compensation is based on OBMC, overlapped block motion compensation. And so I recently published a draft on how all of that works. The main reason that we are using that is because we are using lap transforms as our transform. We don't want to have any blocking artifacts introduced by the motion compensation, because then it would be hard for the lap transforms to get rid of those, because they don't code hard block edges well like a non-lap transform would. Traditional OBMC, as originally proposed back in the 90s, was all done with a fixed block size. So we have extended it to work with variable block size. The current block sizes we use for doing motion estimation are actually unrelated to our transform block sizes. So they're coded completely separately, and don't have to be correlated at all. So some other codecs have done overlap block motion compensation with variable block sizes. So one of them was Dirac, but the way they basically did it is the amount of overlap between them was always set to be the minimum amount you could support for your smallest block size. And so even if you're using a very large block, you have a very tiny overlap, which basically means it's roughly equivalent to always having the smallest block size, but just more efficiently signaling what the motion a large region uses the same motion vector. So we actually have larger blending windows for larger block sizes, and we think that gives you some advantage. To do that, we currently have this restriction that adjacent blocks can differ by at most a factor of 2. I believe it's possible to remove that restriction, but that requires some work that we haven't done yet. And for sub-pill filters, so in the past we had been doing some horrible thing where we did six-tap filters for half-pill and bilinear for finer resolutions, and we've now actually converted that to separable six-tap filters for all of our sub-pill positions based on windowed sync and their 7-bit coefficients with no additional rounding between the stages, so you wind up with a little bit of extra precision needed to do all that, but we think it winds up being worth it. So next slide. So how this kind of fits into the codec is that we run OBMC to produce a prediction image for the entire frame. And the reason we do that is that we actually want our predictors to be in the frequency domain. And so by getting a predictor for the whole frame, we can then apply the forward transform that we apply to the input also to the predictor, and that gives us a prediction. That gives us a set of frequency domain coefficients to serve as our predictor, which is what we're going to feed into PVQ. So one of the limitations that we currently have is there's no explicit intramode. So when we do our motion search, like we don't, if something is very hard to predict, we may spend a bunch of extra bits trying to come up with terrible motion vectors to come up with a really bad prediction. And so we had thought that was actually going to be a pretty severe penalty, but it looks like it winds up being pretty small. So we did some experiments over the weekend that suggested it may be as low as in the 2% range. So we plan to fix that eventually, but it winds up being somewhat complicated to do, so we have not done it yet. But I was pleased to find out that it might actually not be as bad as we thought it was. So next slide. At this point, I'll turn it over to Jean-Marc.
Okay, so before I start going through the details of PVQ, which is what we use in DALA, this is what typically happens in video codecs. So we use the motion compensation to compute a motion compensated reference frame, which is the one in the middle here. We subtract that from the input image that we're trying to code, and we end up with a residual, which is shown on the right, and which is what you're actually trying to code in the vast majority of video codecs. Next. And this is absolutely not what we are doing in DALA. So if you, in the explanation that I'm going to give, if you're trying to find where the subtraction is occurring, you're doing it wrong. You will not find the subtraction. Next. So the idea of PVQ, which stands for perceptual vector quantization, the first idea is to separate the coefficients into a gain and a shape. So the gain is, in some sense, the amount of contrast in a block, and the shape is what that contrast actually looks like. And those are coded separately for several different reasons. One is it makes it easier to preserve the amount of contrast, and as opposed to blur the content of the block. It's easier when you have an actual value for that contrast. The second one is it provides a better representation for the coefficients, which I'll explain a bit later. And also it gives us activity masking, also known as adaptive quantization, without the need for signaling, which is actually another thing that's useful we can get out of PVQ. Next slide. So one of the difficulties with using vector quantization that preserves contrast is how do you use prediction? For example, if we had subtracted the prediction from the input frame, the problem we get is that the gain we compute on the difference is no longer the amount of contrast in our block. It becomes the amount of difference between the two, and it doesn't really have a useful perceptual meaning. And we still want to use predictors because, especially in video, the one frame is very highly correlated to the next, so there is absolutely no way we can afford to not use prediction. So the solution we have is to actually transform the whole problem to make it easier to use that prediction with vector quantization. So this here is a 2D projection of what's actually happening in typically 15 or more dimensions up to 128 and sometimes even more. So we start with our input vector, and in this case it's already normalized to the to a unit norm on the unit sphere here. Next. And then we have our predictor, which is also normalized to the unit sphere. And what we're trying to do is really code the information that will make it possible to move from the prediction back to the input vector that we were trying to code. And we want to do that in n dimensions. This is just a projection on two dimensions. Next. So the first thing we do is we compute this reflection plane called the Householder reflection. And this plane is computed entirely based on the prediction, which means it's available in the decoder. We do not need to signal the information needed to compute that prediction plane. The reflection plane. So once we apply the reflection, the reflection plane is designed to move the prediction exactly onto one of our axes. So by doing that, it makes the whole problem a lot easier, because now we know the prediction is perfectly aligned. The input obviously is still at the same distance from the prediction as it was before. Next slide. Which means we can actually compute an angle between the prediction and the value that we're trying to code. So the smaller the angle, the closer our input is to the prediction. Next. And so once we have that angle, then we know exactly where we are along the special dimension where we've projected the prediction. And so the only coefficients we're now interested in are the other coefficients that are orthogonal to the to that special axis. So we started with we started it in n dimensions. We coded this special theta parameter, and we're left in n minus one dimensions. And we're also constrained to being on the sphere, so we actually have n minus 2 degrees of freedom that are left to code. Next slide. So what does this do? So first thing is it creates a new, what we call an intuitive parameter theta. It's no longer just a random DCT coefficient that we have to code. Theta actually means something. It is how close we are to the prediction. And it's hopefully something that we can better predict compared to normal DCT coefficients. And as I said earlier, theta equals zero just means we use the predictor exactly, which still means that we can adjust the gain. So this is a way that we can actually code fades and things like that. We can change the amount of contrast by still keeping the same shape for the contrast. And so the n minus one dimensions that remain will be coded with vector quantization. So at the n minus 2 degrees of freedom that we have, and we actually know the gain of the dimensions that are left as simply the original gain times the sine of theta that we just coded. So in some sense, instead of subtracting, as I said that we're not doing, we're scaling our prediction and we're reflecting. So it's just a different way to transform the prediction into what we're trying to achieve for the image. Next slide. Now I mentioned earlier that this is used for activity masking purposes, and I don't know how well, yeah, this doesn't come up very well in the, on the projector. The idea is if you see the original slides, you have the original image on top, and if we add some noise, you get a noisy image at the bottom. And in regions that are very flat, the noise is very noticeable, at least in, if you look at it on your laptop. And in regions of high contrast, then we can tolerate a lot more noise. And in general, it would be nice if the codec could actually adapt and use high resolution on flat areas, lower resolution on non-flat areas. And it would be even better if we could do that without having to explicitly code, you know, changes in the quantizer. And this is what we can easily do with PVQ. Next slide. So the idea with activity masking as implemented in DALA is to change the resolution to be higher in low contrast area, so low gain areas, and high, more coarser resolution in higher contrast. And this can be done simply by companding the gain that we're trying to code. So on the left, you see the no activity masking case. So the beta exponent is simply 1. So the points there are the valid quantizer values for 2 dimensions, and they're spread relatively equally in space. And on the right side, this is what happens when the gain is companded. So for low contrast area, so close to the origin, we get better resolution. So we can code smaller details that way. And for points that are further from the origin, so larger contrast, then the spacing is greater, which means that we actually quantize more coarsely the regions of higher contrast. And this is done automatically without having to signal anything. It's just the shape of the gain quantizer that is different. Next slide. Now, one detail I haven't mentioned yet is the bands, the frequency bands that we use for this. First thing is the DC is coded completely separately. It's not at all involved in PVQ. For that, we use hard DC. We use a hard transform on intra or just the difference for inter. And for AC coefficients, what we do is we do the PVQ process in different frequency bands. We don't put all the frequency coefficients into a single band. Rather, we split them. For now, the layout is kind of ad hoc, and the scan order for each of these bands is optimized to have decreasing variance. Next slide. And this here shows the actual structure that we're using. So at the top left, we see what happens on 4x4 blocks where we have a single DC coefficient and then 15 coefficients that are encoded with PVQ. For 8x8 blocks, what we do is we still have the same structure as 4x4 for the lower frequencies, but then we add 3 more bands, one for the highest horizontal frequency, one for the highest vertical frequencies, and one for diagonal-like coefficients. And as we go to larger block sizes, we keep the same structure for the lower bands, and we add 3 more bands every time we go up 1 block size. This here is shown for up to 32 by 32, but we'll soon have 64 by 64 as well. So the last aspect of PVQ is sometimes it actually happens that the prediction is actually really bad and that it's uncorrelated or even negatively correlated with what we're trying to code. And so we could have simply coded a theta value larger than pi over 2, but that seemed kind of pointless in this case because it could introduce artifacts from the prediction. And the way we did it instead is to simply add another flag called no ref for no reference. And when that flag is set, it actually means discard the prediction and just do plain vector quantization on the input. And I will hand back the mic to Tim.
Thank you, Jean-Marc. So as I showed on the slides earlier, we do a couple more things to come up with predictors and interframes. So one of them is on the LUMA coefficients. We have this horizontal and vertical interprediction. And basically all this does is we copy the first row or column of coefficients from our neighbors to the corresponding bands in PVQ. So we only do this if the size of the corresponding blocks match.
But the interesting thing compared to the way most interprediction is implemented is that we actually copy both the row and the column from our neighbors, and then we use PVQ's no reflex to decide whether or not we should actually use that prediction. For the first band, so if you go to the couple slides back, you see the first band up there, those that actually has pieces of both the first row and the first column, so back, which means we need to pick which one we want to copy because we generally aren't going to want to use both. And so right now we're just copying from the neighbor with the highest energy, which again requires no signaling to decide. Since that is all done in interframes, so you know there's no worry about desync or anything like that. So we don't have an explicit intra mode to decide between horizontal and vertical. We just use these PVQ no ref flags that we already have to decide whether or not we're using this prediction. So next slide. In the chroma planes, we use chroma from Luma. So the idea is we basically just straight copy the coefficients that we had for Luma into the chroma planes as our predictor for PVQ. So when other people have implemented chroma from Luma, they've tried to do stuff like build a linear model from your neighbors of how chroma gets mapped into Luma. And we don't do that because PVQ basically does that for us, right? Because we have this separate gain parameter that we're already coding, which is exactly the scale we want to code. And then we have split DC out separately. So DC is not predicted in either case. And that would be the offset that you would have in your linear model. So we're basically already coding the coefficients of a linear model. And we originally had one where we built our own linear model, and then we're basically using PVQ to code a correction for that, but it wound up being no better than just coding the things directly. So we deleted a bunch of code and got something that worked just as well. Better. But one additional complication is that when you're predicting chroma from Luma, you can actually have something that is negatively correlated with the Luma coefficients, and that makes sense. So we add an additional flip flag that will reverse the whole predictor, which we code for each block, we code only one flip flag on the first band where we actually have a non-no ref value. So we're actually using a predictor. And as I said, we are not doing any DC prediction from either in Luma or in chroma from Luma. We're just simply using hard DC, as we mentioned earlier, to code DC over large areas. So, Mo?
Mo Zanatti from the floor, Mike. One thing I was curious about, as we're looking at different components and, different color formats and maybe even different, component planes, depth or aux or alpha or something like that. The topic of having some kind of decorrelation among the components always comes up, and whether you do that before as a pre-step or whether you have something, some tool specific for that, or whether you can do prediction from, from one component to another becomes important. Do you see this as being possibly extensible so that you could even do like RGB coding and be able to predict, R and B from G efficiently enough to avoid a pre-correlation transform?
So we have not tested that, so I can't say for certain how well it would perform. My suspicion is that we would need to do better entropy coding of the specific things than we are doing now, right? One of the things that you would expect when doing RGB is that you're going to wind up with a much more consistent gain value of whatever, right? Because the gain is essentially coding like what the scale factor is in your linear model, right? And you're going to expect to have some kind of global gain that is going to be true over the whole frame, right? And then there may be small local variations. And so what we have right now is trying to capture those small local variations, but we don't have any way to capture the global gain that you would expect just on, how correlated do you expect R to be to G generally, right? So it may be possible to model that entirely with entropy coding just by predicting those gains in a better way or something like that, but we have not tried to do that.
Okay. Yeah, Nathan Nagy, Mozilla. To answer Mo's question a little bit more directly, the way the chroma from Luma works, it has an assumption that there's a linear model in the correlation. So if you have RGB and you assume it's linear, then maybe chromophilia could work, but from a depth field or some auxiliary plane, that may not be the case, so that may not work.
All right, next slide. So the quantization, so we use PVQ to quantize things generally, but there are some more details to that. So we actually have a per coefficient quantizer scale. This is a change if you looked at some of the stuff we had done recently where we only had stuff per band. So basically we define an 8x8 matrix and then interpolate that down for 4x4 or up for larger block sizes. And then we have a separate step where we compensate for the different basis magnitudes of the lattice transforms as I described earlier. So it would probably be good to get these combined into one step, but we have not done that yet. And this quantization is basically trying to compensate for contrast sensitivity and is one of the reasons that we generally tend to do better on perceptual metrics than we do on PSNR. We also, as Jean-Marc described, have this built-in activity masking. That probably actually shouldn't have been on the slide at all because we've already talked about it. Next slide. Entropy coding. So there's a draft on here, which has been resubmitted for NetVC, but has actually been around for a couple years at this point. So entropy coding, we use non-binary arithmetic coding. And one of the reasons that we do this is a lot of the computational overheads for arithmetic coding are per symbol. And so when you do binary arithmetic coding, each symbol can only be true or false, right? So in order to code values with many more than two possibilities, you need to clock lots of symbols through your arithmetic coder. So we allow coding symbols that have many more than two possibilities, which reduces the number of symbols that we need to code. So that also reduces the amount of overhead we pay on a per symbol basis. So there were a lot of attempts in for example, HEVC to try to do some kind of parallel entropy coding because this has become one of the bottlenecks in hardware implementations since you're limited. This is an inherently serial process for the most part. It controls your clock rates, and your clock rates control the amount of power you have to spend. Getting that down gives you an improvement in hardware power usage. So our solution was just to code fewer symbols rather than try to do that in parallel. So it's essentially a kind of parallelism. And for example, when you're doing the search in the decoder for which one of those many values that you actually coded, you can do that all in SIMD arithmetic, for example. So the particular arithmetic coder we use is a multiply-free version based on this design by Sweaver and Moffitt from 1998. And so what this happens is we have some range of possible values, and we're trying to select one of those values in there, and we want to split that up into regions that are proportional to the probabilities of the different symbols that we can code. So for example, here I'm saying that the first symbol has a probability of has a proportional probability of 8, and the next one is 2, which is 1/4 as likely as 8, and the next two are each 1. So I want to split up my range down here at the bottom, which, for purposes of examples of size 32, into regions that are roughly proportional to those probabilities at the top. And to do that, I scale them so that I have the total of my probabilities winds up being within half of and twice as much of the range there at the bottom. And then I use this function up here at the top, which is just C, where C is this count of how far you are through there, through the probability distribution, so the cumulative probability, plus the min of C and R minus the total, where total is the total of my cumulative probability distribution. And that winds up overestimating low probability things and underestimating high probability things, but it's really cheap to compute. Like, there's no multiplies, there's nothing more complicated there than a min and a subtraction. And so that gives you stuff that is roughly proportional to the probabilities you had as input and allows a really flexible design on how you do your probability modeling, right? So this basically has all of the modeling flexibility of the original arithmetic coding design back in the 70s with something that is roughly as fast as the very highly optimized coders that we have for specific binary things, right? So we support up to 15-bit probabilities, alphabet sizes up to 16. So that means that each symbol we code can have one of 16 possible values, which is like coding 4 bits. So that would be equivalent to 4 symbols in a binary arithmetic coder. So it speeds things up by a factor of 4, roughly, if we can keep the number of symbols we code as close to this maximum as possible. So sometimes we don't have 16 possibilities to code, but I think right now we're running at somewhere around 2 bits per symbol as our average. So the difficulty here by this design is that we have to come up with new ways of modeling these probabilities because the traditional binary approaches don't work. So one of those is we can use frequency counts as people have used for 30 or 40 years. The other things that we have tried is coming up with specific statistical models. Like we might say we're coding something that comes from approximately a Laplace distribution. We know what a Laplace distribution looks like, and we can model that with one parameter, for example, the expected value. And so we adapt to the expected value, and we use that to compute probabilities for the whole distribution. We also have this thing we call the generic coder, which we have used in places where we didn't really know how to model the thing we were trying to model. And it's designed to basically never do too badly, regardless of what you throw at it. And that's probably overcomplicated and something we should replace. But for simple experimental work, it has been really useful. So next slide. We also support raw bits. So instead of having a bypass mode or anything like that, where you try to code symbols that you don't want to actually entropy code in a simplified manner, what we instead do is something that we did in Opus, which is we just tack the bits onto the end of the frame in reverse order. So it winds up being much simpler than trying to integrate something into the entropy coder. The only difficulty is that when you're now reading in these bits in your decoder, you have to read them from two different places, depending on whether you want entropy coded values or raw bits. All right, next slide. So those are the things that we currently have implemented in DALLA, and there's probably some details that I left out, but we have lots of things that we still have left to do, so I don't mean by any means to imply that DALLA is completed. So for example, like PVQ is currently all implemented with double precision arithmetic, which is obviously terrible. So we did that to make sure that we had something that worked well before we tried to spend a bunch of time optimizing it. We actually had an optimized version in fixed point first, and none of it worked, and we couldn't figure out why, so we threw it all away and did the double precision one, and now have something that works much better. So we currently have no B frames at all. That is something we are working on. Our motion compensation blocks only go up to 32 by 32, so we're working on adding 64 by 64 support. Said earlier, we're working on 64 by 64 transforms. There are lots of potential ways that our motion search could be improved. There are lots of ways to exploit PVQ that we have not talked about. So, trying to get some kind of global correlation out of the gains or global correlation out of theta, various things like that, we have not even begun to experiment with yet. As I said earlier, the generic coder probably should be replaced by more targeted probability modeling. We don't really have very much post-processing at the moment, so we actually have one filter that we added relatively recently. But we plan to have things like a deringing filter. We're now experimenting with the constrained low-pass filter from Thor that presumably you'll hear about on Wednesday. But there are lots of other things that we could do that we have not experimented with yet. So I think that is the end. All right. So are there any other questions? Well, great. If you guys have suggestions, come find us. Tell us on the list. We'd love to hear them.
That's all. So whoever has the blue sheets, if you could either bring them up here or hold them up. Oh, excellent. Thanks. I'll come get you from you, Robert. I also want to thank everyone for I've never had a working group have presentations end precisely on time. I don't know how you did it, but do it again in the future.
No questions.
Oh, yeah.
If anybody's on the blue sheets, please grab them. Reminder, we have a Wednesday session, too. Wednesday session is at 4 p.m., I believe. 3:50 p.m.
Yeah, sure. By the way, nice to meet you. Thank you very much for stepping in.